Francis Kong is one of the country's most sought-after motivational speakers. I could listen to Francis' jokes the whole day, as they normally have a profound lesson at the end. Many people get stuck in a rut, not necessarily a financial rut, but a mental block. It can be hard to pull yourself out without help. Today, Francis will inspire and motivate you to move forward and realize your goals. We hope that he will motivate you to move from cannot to can do as you go through your own journey. I'm Edric Mendoza, and this is On The Money. Hello, Francis.
Hello, Edric.
So glad to have you finally on the show.
Thank you for inviting me. This is a great honor for me to be here on your show. Yeah.
So let's talk about your story.
Okay.
Tell us about insights, learnings. I mean, how money became a lesson in your life and bless the viewers.
The next time you hear somebody say, money is not everything, I can assure you the speaker doesn't have money. Or is probably talking about your money.
Right.
Money is not everything, says Zig Ziglar, but it's as reasonably close to oxygen.
Right.
So the fact is, money is central to every person's life. It was central to my life. It is still central today. And so the idea is that I've learned a lot of life lessons, not just making money, but understanding money in itself. And so money for me is simply an idea.
Right.
Now, a lot of people are focused on the physical aspect of money. What they fail to understand is it is simply an idea, because that piece of money, you can't even eat it, right? And so that money is just a medium of exchange. It affords you with a tool in order for you to exchange something with that piece of money with a product or a service,
right.
Edric. Yeah. And so what you do now is you have to understand it involves exchange. In other words, there must be things you have to exchange in order to get more money. And those are the things I've learned in my life too.
Excellent. Tell me about how it started for you. Remember when you were sharing about how you started with your first few businesses?
Yeah.
That's a really inspiring story.
Well, you know, Edric, just like everybody else, I started life with being an employee. I've always wanted to be in the garments business because I love fashion. And
I can see that.
Good. Does that give me an opportunity to be one of the models in this country? Now, here's the key. My first start in the garments industry in fashion was not exactly very glamorous. I was one of the key people who we were fixing show windows in department store. And that was my start. But the very little money that I was making then, I was pouring it all on books. I would buy books on sales, I would buy books on marketing, I would buy books on public relations and presentations and stuff like that, because I wanted to go to the next level.
Right.
I may be good in what I'm doing, but I'm never satisfied with where I was,
right.
And I want to go to the next level.
Right.
So I started learning about sales, and then eventually I had a dream. My dream was to be in sales. When I got a position as a salesperson, now my next dream would be I want to be marketing. And when I got the position, I said, what if one day I will be running this company? And I was running the company until the next level was, what if I become an entrepreneur and own my own business? And so it is a process. It took years, but in the process, I've learned some pretty good things about it.
Wonderful. I love how you said, especially that the little that you made then, you invested not in frivolous things, but in bettering yourself, in learning.
Right.
So that's a very good principle about where to put money.
Exactly. Where do you get the raw material for money? If I say that money is just an idea, where do you get it? An idea is raw materials from concepts, right? And you get your best concepts from knowledge, and you seek knowledge, Edric. Rarely does knowledge interrupt you while you're watching a pirated DVD program. And so you seek knowledge, you seek education, you add value to your understanding of things, and then that would later on build your skills, and then you offer your skills, and you add value to what you're doing and what you can do in exchange. You get more money.
Excellent. So it ties back to that principle of the exchange you said earlier.
Exactly.
Learning more things, developing yourself, putting money in those things that will help develop your knowledge and skill sets will actually pay back. And then later on, that's the exchange.
And in fact, there's a question I want to ask you, Edric. You've got dreams too, right?
Yes,
I have dreams.
Yeah.
So when people ask me, how do I make my dreams come true? Right. My initial response is wake up and do some work. Don't keep on dreaming.
Right.
There's got to be some activity placed into your dreams and your ideas in life, and that's what life is all about.
Wonderful. So you were also sharing with me in your own story and in dreaming, right? You said that you did not want to instantly gain money. Oh, I like that principle. Tell us more about that.
Well, the fact is, if you study the lives of the previous lotto winners, most of them today ended up with more miserable lives compared to the day before they won the prize. Why? Because that lotto ticket is simply a paper that propels you, like a rocket fueled by aviation gas. Your trajectory becomes very steep, such that your landing is equally steep too, into your area of success. Now here's the problem. Success requires skills to handle. Meanwhile, the ordinary person skills like you and me, we have to go through the rigors and the trivia and the petty little things wherein we go to work every day, we sweat it out, we meet our horrible bosses who behave more like jerks sometimes. But you know what we're doing, Edric? We are actually winning. What we're doing now is we are processing, we are learning. And so the reason why we don't want instant money, it is because there's no learning process there. Yeah, even if you give me money right now, but I never went through the process. That will not build me, and I won't be able to handle money.
That's really true. That money easily gained,
easily lost.
Money easily lost.
That's so true.
Right. Tell me, even as we were talking, you said there were insights from other people who have made quite a lot of money, like Paul Getty.
Oh right.
Share with us the insights you had there.
Well, Paul Getty says, if you want to be a millionaire, there are three steps. Are you interested?
Go ahead. Let's hear it. I think our viewers want to hear this.
Step number one, wake up early.
Wake up early.
Step number two, work hard.
What is early? Like 4 a.m., 5? Depends. Early.
If you're working in the BPO, then that's a different time frame. Step number one, wake up early. Step number two, work hard. Step number three, find oil. So here,
in his case, right?
So here's now my question. What is your oil field? You and I, we have to look for our own oil field. I can't be somebody I'm not meant to be. I mean, if somebody is rich, he has his own oil field. I have to look for my own oil field, and then I have to dig and dig and dig and mine and mine and mine. And so the same principle applies. A lot of hard work put into it.
How does a person know if they found their oil field? You said dig and dig and mine. I mean, let's say there are people in the corporate world, they're trying different paths or careers, how will they know that this is finally their oil field?
Well, I'm going to share a secret with you, Edric. And normally, when I do this in my seminars, they pay me a lot of money. But for you, this is going to be free.
I love this.
You first have to understand what your gift zones are. What is your gift zone? What makes you happy? What would propel you to do that very thing you love to do, even though they're not going to pay you for it?
That's a good principle.
You know, a lot of people would call that passion. I would call that that's your giftedness.
Giftedness.
Now, One principle I've learned in life, Edric, is this. Your gifts and your skills, your gifts and your talents are God-given. You can't do anything about it. You speak well, you can dance, I can't dance, so we have different
That's just
talents,
an example for the record.
Yeah,
I don't think neither of us can dance, okay, right.
But since our talents are God-given, skills are what we build for ourselves. We gotta build those talents into skills. Talents that are not built are talents buried under the ground, and it goes to waste. Now, once you build it and it becomes a skill, and you know that you're consumed by it, even though you're not being paid for it, therefore, you've discovered your oil field. And the next thing to understand is, don't focus on the money. Focus on what help you can provide for others. Money becomes a delightful byproduct.
That's wonderful.
In the exercise, isn't it?
Yeah. So focus on things that you are passionate about or giftedness. Focus on areas that you can help, and then money becomes a byproduct. Francis, do you have any lessons in money where you actually learn things the hard way? Because there are many people who might be learning it the hard way. You know, for example, tried this, didn't work, and then realized maybe because of this, here's my oil field.
Everything.
Is that possible?
That's so possible, Edric. And everything that I've learned it through the hard way. Principle number one, there's no shortcut to success. Principle number two, the process is more important than the success. Mm. When you go through the process, you learn. Principle number three, most people give up at not just one important inflection point wherein had you stayed a little bit longer, you would have gone over,
right,
and then you start reaping the
sayang moments, no?
Sayang
moments, okay.
You know, ayoko na, I can't do this anymore, right. I quit, this is too hard for me. A lot of people have quit even before the game is done.
Mm.
And so you stick to it, you work on it, there's no shortcut to success. Mm.
How will a person know? That's a great principle. Now, if a person is at that sayang point or they don't want to hit that point, how will they know? I should be pushing a little bit harder, even if I have a horrible boss, or even if the numbers don't seem to make sense, I should stretch this a little bit longer. Any advice that you can give to people who might be in that situation right as we are airing this? Yeah.
Well, one advice is call up your program and ask for advice, right?
Or Twitter or Facebook, Twitter,
But on the serious side, you know what scriptures would say? Excellent business advice. In a multitude of counselors, there is wisdom. Ask.
Good counsel.
I mean, go to people who are mature, who've gone through life, and ask them for advice. Second, you don't have any options if you're not reading books. You won't have any other alternatives if you're not learning. So you gotta learn. That's why life is a non-stop learning process. Just keep on learning. That way you arm yourself with a lot of options.
Excellent. Do you have any heroes when it comes to people who have dealt with their money well and many maybe learnings? I mean, you are an icon already as it is, but let's get into your brain and see, do you have people that you admire and say, you know, this guy has done it well. What can we learn?
Well, I have icons or I have role models, and most of them are staying with me in my home library.
Really? Yeah. Okay. Expound.
So, I'll give you an example. Peter Drucker is such a rock star in management. He was very successful. I'll get the best practices and the best learnings from Peter Drucker. My biographies will show me that Winston Churchill, despite battling depression, he was a merchant of hope. Had it not been for his optimism, England might have fallen into the hands of the Nazis. And I will study the resolve and the determination of MacArthur, and I'll study all these great business people, and I'll study the visionary ideas of our current business leaders, and I have so many of them. My unique position right now, because I do consultancy work, and most of them are the top corporations in the Philippines, I learn from these leaders. Just by asking them questions, within 5 minutes, I get knowledge that would surpass my two-day learning experience in Harvard.
Right.
And so I have icons. In business, we have a term called best practices. So I learn best practices from this guy and from that guy, put them up together, and find out how it will work in my
life. Your life. Excellent. Yeah. You know, I'm inspired all over again.
Oh,
you're
thank
such a
you.
Really a great mentor, Francis. We're taking a quick break now. Keep it here. On the Money, we'll be right back.
Interested in getting and staying rich, Warren Buffett is up there in the list of what Bloomberg calls investors with rock status. If teenagers have Harry Potter, fans of value investing have Snowball, the only authorized autobiography of Warren Buffett. It offers a great peek into what makes Buffett tick. It was his intensity, focus, and persistence that allowed him to be rich beyond everybody's dreams. He discovered the magic of compounding before he turned 11 when he read a book from the public library by chance. Autobiographer Alice Schroeder describes Warren Buffett as a cash hoarder. We Filipinos are just the opposite. We collect debt. But Warren Buffett showed during the financial crisis that you can only take advantage of investment opportunities when you have the cash. You're a great Warren Buffett fan. You not only admire him, you bought shares in Berkshire Hathaway.
Well, I was lucky to buy it at that time. One of the reasons why I bought it was to attend the meeting. But you're correct, because eventually, I mean now, even now, I realize it was a very good time to have bought Berkshire shares.
It must have been so exciting to go to the annual meeting. What was it like for you?
We were a group of Filipinos coming from Philippines, California, and we all met in Omaha. We were all excited. In fact, by 4 a.m., we were already lining up. We thought about where to line up, which staircase to run.
There's a lot of stockholders during the annual stockholders.
It's about 35,000. It's like a rock concert wherein at 7 a.m. they open the doors, all the doors.
Okay.
And it's free seating.
Okay.
So what you have is they open all the doors and people are running towards the center of the arena.
Tell me more about you.
I've started since I was 11.
11 years old, just like Warren.
My dad ran a brokerage, so we were naturally exposed to the stock market.
What made you continue that until now? And now, can you show your Berkshire Hathaway?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, look at that.
Yes, oh yeah. These are exclusive shirts. So as time passed, I guess these are the good things about learning lessons or making mistakes. So along the way when I was younger, I made a lot of mistakes, big mistakes. And that's what led me towards fundamental research, value investing.
Can you share any of your favorite stories of Warren?
It would be the one which he gave to answer the question, how would you define success? He shared a story of a friend of his who was a Jew. This person had to run away from Europe, right, to survive the Holocaust. During the Holocaust, during World War II, right, they were going after the Jews. The Jews had very little with them. Friends, did you have friends? Who could you trust? So that was the question. Every time this person now looks at a person, she thinks to her mind, will this person hide me? You know, when it comes down to that, will that person hide me? And Buffett then continues on to say, at the age of 60 or 70, at the end of your days, if you have a lot of people that will hide you, you're a success.
Before turning you over to Edric and Melissa, here's how I felt after reading this book, borrowing from one of my favorite TV shows. Box Me. This is the key to getting from Kent to Ken.
Time now to answer some of the questions you sent to us via email, Twitter, and Facebook. Melissa Hekulea has those questions. Hi, Mel.
Hi, Edric. Hello, Francis.
Hello.
Actually, you know, your story was so interesting, and I just have one question to ask before we get started.
Sure, go for it.
You mentioned that in your process, you wanted to learn more about some things, one of which was sales. I wanted to know, did you take any courses or classes to kind of help move yourself along?
I love that question. I graduated top in my college. But that never gave me a chip on my shoulder or feeling of pride saying that I know everything now. But I just made sure that I put my money on books. And so my books were in my classroom. My cheap secondhand car was my mobile university because I would listen to cassettes during those days.
Wow.
So now it's cassettes.
Yeah.
Right.
I started life when I was 12. Right. That was how I learned.
So he was like homeschooling.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Like homeschooling.
Right. Teaching himself, you know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. Thank you, Francis.
You're welcome.
Well, the first question actually comes from Dennis of Davao. He says, I am burnt out and unhappy in my current job. I'm in my late 30s and I'm considering a career change or going into filmmaking, which has been my lifelong dream. What do you advise he does here?
don't give up your day job. Okay. If you're burned out, you need a rest. Why would you change career for? You see, a lot of people mistake being tired with giving up in his career, and they're gonna try something else. Okay, now, if you were forced into doing something because for the money thing of that, then you feel that your passion lies somewhere else, then that's good. But if you're not feeling well and you feel burnt out, just take a rest.
Okay. Right. Although he does say that filmmaking is his passion, it's his lifelong dream, is it worth it for him to maybe study filmmaking or work on a set? Yeah.
So my next question is, why don't you do something during your spare time? Maybe the joy of doing filmmaking might sort of overcome your feeling of being burned out with doing a job that you've been doing. And my suggestion is, try it out first. Don't give up your day job just like
He's in his late 30s. Is there an age you think that it's too late for anyone?
It is never too late for anyone to have a brand new beginning. Here's the one thing I want people to understand. I've had people coming to me saying, Francis, should I resign from my job because I'm not happy with my work anymore? My standard response is, well, show me a job or you can be happy all the time. I resign and join you. What are you saying?
There's always days like that.
There are always days
you burn out.
There are days that are, you know, bad hair days, even for people without hair.
It's true. But also follow your passion is something you were saying earlier.
Yeah, try it out.
Don't do it too drastically.
Yeah,
right?
Don't be too drastic.
Because you
could
be emotional and worked up. Okay.
Yes, so try it out, dip your toe in, and then see if you like it and want to pursue it.
Right, that's the safest thing.
Perfect. Okay, next question comes from Karen via Twitter. She says, I feel I am stuck in a pattern of paycheck, bills, expenses, and I am unable to spend for the things I want. I don't know how to change this situation. Can you help me?
Sure. And I'd like to tell Karen, don't change your situation, change you. I mean, the question I want to ask you is, how much money are you spending? Are you taking a careful inventory on your incoming and your outgoing? Maybe the reason why you can't save enough is because you are not careful of the tiny little leaks in your lifestyle that goes to waste, because a tiny little leak can bring down an entire ship.
Right.
Now, a pen and a paper and a diligent heart recording every single cent that you spend can give you a better idea on, are you really not making enough or are you not really saving enough?
So she should look at it on paper, see what she's spending, and then I suppose try to get out of this mindset rut that she's in.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Sweating the small stuff. I think Paul Getty was talking about that somewhere, making sure you get the details, right? Because you might overlook it.
Everything is in the details, actually.
Sweat. Sometimes it pays to sweat the small stuff.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. Exactly.
Do a lot of people get stuck in these cycles, these cycles they never seem to get out of? I mean, what can you say for those people?
Well, most people would say, if only I can get a pay raise, then my life would become better. If only I can earn more money. Here's the fantastic thing I've noticed about this. You increase the salary of a person, his lifestyle slowly but automatically increases too, right? Secondly, watch this. Mindset is so important. I love the phrase. In the West, when you have excess money, what do you call that? Disposable income.
Right.
So if that is your mindset, what do you do with your income?
You dispose it.
In Asia, when you have excess money, it's called saving. So if that's your term and your mindset, what do you do with the excess money? You save it. And so words are powerful. Okay. It frames our thoughts.
Change that paradigm, right?
Yeah, that's right. I like that. So changing disposable
to savings.
At the
end of the month, you don't make disposable income. You actually make savings, right?
Exactly. Yes. Perfect.
Excellent.
Okay, next, Patrick emailed us asking how he can have a healthier attitude to money, because everywhere he looks, people see it as the only sign of success. He says, I don't want my children to grow up thinking this way either.
I love that question, Patrick. And what is the real worth of a person? The measure of a worth of a person is how much are you worth when every cent is removed away from you. Never could you find, the Bible says, money is the root of all evil. But the Bible does say the love of money is the root of all evil.
Ah, okay.
Therefore, here's the key.
Not
money is an attitude problem. So to someone who has a good attitude and good values, money is a very productive tool. But for somebody with a lousy attitude, money is a lethal drug. Mm.
Right.
And money can change saints into sinners when they don't know that money is just a tool. How you use it or how you misuse it, that those are the real issues in life.
Right.
So the way I would do that for Patrick, I would teach my children money is not that important. Mm. Learn to have a healthy attitude on knowing how to use money and never being used by money.
Mm. Ah,
it's
nice.
Not an end goal, right?
Not an
it's an enabler. I think you're talking about the exchange and all
exactly.
that.
Yeah.
So that's good advice.
Yeah, excellent that is
advice.
Good advice. And it's good that his children can learn that at a young age.
They can start early.
Because if you grow up with that mindset, because your parents never teach you, then you're stuck.
Right? I mean, that popular song you were talking about earlier, I Want to Be a Billionaire, right? I mean, it's pop
not
culture
a millionaire,
now.
So, but a billionaire.
Yeah. So obviously, he needs to correct that. That's not your end goal.
Somebody was saying, "Oh, so I want to be like that. I'm billionaire. No, freaking bad."
The freaking bad part.
Oh my God!
Right, right. So mindset change early on.
Thank you so much,
You're
Francis.
Welcome.
I'm so sorry. That's all we have time for. But thank you for coming on the show. Anyway, send us your money questions via email or through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our Q&A Fridays.
Powerful insights. Francis, Mel, money is not the end goal. That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talk and tips so you're always right on the money.